together, and they were communicating their lives to each other by playing games. Think of it almost as like the games being like musical instruments, okay? These were games of expression, not escapism. What I saw was quite different from what I saw in the game industry at the time, and it fascinated me to like to an extreme extent. It became this new obsession. So I partially lost sight of that vision about games. Not in terms of my mind, because I've thought about that vision every day since it came in 2010, but in terms of my actions and how I was prioritizing things. Okay? I was overwhelmed and I was escaping from it. Escape is fine. If you don't go home from your work, then you definitely need to escape your work. There's a time for each part. Escapism, once it has some teeth in you though, it seeks to make itself the only thing on the schedule, and it ends up out of control quickly. So you only have to know one alcoholic, one drug addict, or one food addict, or a workaholic to realize escapism can be a slippery slope, and when it gets serious, it gets very serious. I wasn't expressing my life in my games. I've become this cheap imitation of other game developers that were considered successful or even mildly successful, and I only partially put my spin on it. I didn't even agree with them, like not totally anyway. I was just trying to make a difference, but I was trying to do it in a way that I knew wasn't going to work for me. I think I knew that deep down. I hated the tools I was working with, I hated what my process had become, and I had ridiculous fatigue every day, especially for somebody not even getting paid. It was basically gambling, okay? But it was gambling with years of my life instead of money. And ironically, I kept at it until I finally broke down on March 21st, 2019. The little kid who couldn't stop talking enthusiastically about Earthworm Jim with his elementary school teachers found himself wandering around San Francisco by himself at GDC, crying and avoiding eye contact with people. Something had happened that day with a mentor of mine at the time that deeply hurt my feelings and made me want to just give up on the game industry. I had this whole plan. I was gonna quit, and I was gonna work at this parking lot, and I was like, okay, well, I could get this umbrella here, and I could just start working there at the parking lot. Like, serious. I was like, it's just time to give up on this stupid vision, 2010. Mitchell's already gone. This wouldn't be anything to honor his legacy. What am I saying? You know, these people don't want anything to change. Was it even really something from God? Who am I kidding? You know, what am I doing with my life? Like, I dropped out of college to throw my life away. That's where I was at. But thankfully, my friends got me back in line. I ended up having to do some serious soul searching. And a lot changed for me during this time. So June 2nd that year, I gave my life to Jesus after he miraculously freed me from depression. I rethought my life position of my work, ignored a lot of generally accepted knowledge about game development, and have been building up carefully, slowly, but now it's going far stronger than it all ever was before. And then this past year it became clear, spiritually, why this all occurred the way it did, and how it can be used to create this paradigm shift of games as escapism, to make games as expression, okay? It has to do with something we don't talk about at all, really, in video games, but will get us to the heart of escapism versus expression. It's unconditionality. So for something to be unconditional, it has to have no conditions, okay? So unconditional respect means, for example, you respect someone no matter what they do, okay? Unconditional love means you love someone no matter what they do. And unconditional play is what you need to have expression in games. Okay. The famous sports psychology book, adored by Super Smash Bros. Melee players the world over, The Inner Game of Tennis, talks quite a bit about the concept of quieting the conscious mind and to allow the subconscious mind to work the way it does best. Okay. Talks about detaching from the conscious thought of the game and then just existing within the game, okay? Non-judgmentally, and that's how you play at your best. If you're telling yourself, oh man, that was seriously terrible, better not do that again, then you are quieting the conscious mind. That's the theory. And that it will negatively affect your play if you do it that way. Okay? So, David, this seems like actually all over the place. Can you please stop talking in circles and say how this makes sense? If it even is supposed to make sense? All right, I will. I promise. I told you, just bear with me. So, what happened to play for the sake of play? Just play for the sake of play. Think about it. I didn't run to the computer when I was little to play Earthworm Jim because I needed to. Okay. I wasn't addicted to the game. I just loved the game. Even when I did terribly, and that was like straight up 100% of the time back then. Like we had no concept of video games before my brother got me to play Earthworm Jim that day with him. He got it as a present. We didn't know anything about games. I mean, we were trying all the keys on the keyboard just to figure out how to move, okay, at first. We didn't know anything, nothing. And our dad had to put in the disc and open the game on the computer. Like, we had no clue, okay? We had no clue what we were doing. But it was fascinating, okay? It could only be just so fascinating until my mom, you know, would kick us off the computer after like half an hour. But, you know, those were like the hypest minutes of the day. Okay, we didn't get to play for hours. So what happened to making games for the sake of play? Think about it. I mean, crunch time for deadlines, free-to-play monetization, whales, reviews, sales numbers. Like, when I think of play in the purest sense, I don't think of the things the game industry is known for doing right now. Okay? Just another funny slide. I'm not hating on anybody. I just thought it was funny. It's a good meme. So the metaverse, everybody's talking about it. Metaverse is touted by some to be a better version of the real world, like a replacement almost. Okay. What about the most significant aspect of the real world? It's real. Okay. When I experience something in the game, and I play a lot of games, the experience in the game world isn't necessarily real, but my experience with the game is real. Okay? That's a serious distinction that we have to think about as designers. Okay? I mean, look, I'm not that much of a fan of VR for its immersive advantages, you know? Because I mean, I feel like it's not for me avoiding it. Like, that was me. I was the first person to try the PlayStation VR at GDC, okay? I've been into it, okay? But the immersion's already there. With any technology arcade game. I mean, think about Pac-Man, okay? When I die in the game, I say, drat, I died, you know? Or I try to stay focused at least a little bit. I don't say, oh, well, a ghost got Pac-Man. Wow. I'm already in the game. It's from 1980. Like, come on. I just don't buy it, man. I don't buy it. I don't think I want my favorite games to replace real. I mean, think about Quake 3. I don't want that to be real. That's too intense for me, dude. Like Resident Evil 4? Nope. That's a no for me, dog. So, but I mean, like, we already have MMOs that have replaced people's lives. I mean, and a good lot of them are unfortunately conversation points for addictive psychology, unfortunately. Seriously, I mean, on the addictive kind of psychological manipulation side, like, why are so many games resembling casinos now? In the worst ways. Like, not even in an exciting way, just like in the absolute worst ways. And nothing's even being done. Like, it's being rewarded. It's being rewarded. That's not good for our industry, you know? Not for long term, anyway. Like, this is a very slippery slope for our medium. It's a medium. And we need to be thinking about this with our long term thinking hats on. I don't wear hats, but, you know. So, speaking of rewards for negative things, why do so many games come out that straight up just don't work, like I was talking about before? And the publishers still get millions of dollars, you know? People pay $60 or even just impulse buy on a collector's edition. I do that sometimes too. But sometimes that doesn't even come with the game, the collector's editions. Like, I don't think that's great that they're doing it, but... And they're supposed to play a game, and it doesn't even work, you know? But publishers still get the money. Oh, but you can refund it, right? Well, yeah, right. That's not a solution. Come on. Some of those refund things are great. Some of them just don't. You can't even do that, you know. They expected a certain game. The player expected a certain game. And that's us, too. We're players, too. We buy games. It didn't meet our expectations. I mean, sometimes companies go back and try to fix. Like, No Man's Sky is a brilliant, prominent example. like it launched poorly. Some people were really hyped, and bless them, Sean Murray, Hello Games, they went back. They're like, we're gonna make this right. It is an amazing story. There needs to be a movie about that. So, but most of the times it's just handled very poorly, and it's just a really bad memory for all the gamers, and it can kill a franchise doing stuff like that. Even a long running franchise, it will kill that franchise. Reputation's gone. What in the world are we doing? What are we doing? Like, this is what we need to be thinking about. So play is enormously ignored in the world. I'm talking play for the sake of play. Okay, play. Video games aren't even focusing on play anymore in that sense. They're focusing on that escapism. Okay. Play can be an escape too, but there's so much more to play that's actually positive. Because the lines have been blurred so much between play and escapism. You know, play is commonly seen now as a waste of time, even among development teams. If you're crunching and you're over in the lobby playing Smash with each other, I mean, you're wasting time. That's not how we should be looking at it, okay? Play is not a waste of time, okay? It's valuable. Like, why do you think animals play? It's survival training. Maybe not the chess, but maybe, I don't know. You never know what's gonna happen. So, well, they don't have to work for a living. Okay, sure. But to some extent, that's bushwhack, and you know it, okay? Like, don't justify your own disregard for your own playtime, because I'm telling you, I was workaholic hardcore. I was here too, okay? I'm not trying to be rude about that. Like, I disregarded my own playtime too, okay? Just because you have work pressure and it's how you see value in yourself, it's not healthy, okay? It's not. Our whole industry has an issue with that right now, okay? Play at the most basic level is important for personal development because of the concept that it's the decisions you make when you have no time to make them that define who you are. It's a nice quote from the master in that old internet show, Pure Onage. Anyone know the show? Okay. So, iron sharpens iron as one friend sharpens another. That's the value of competitive gaming right there, in a nutshell. Right there in the book of Proverbs. I mean, what about the wild animals that hunt their own food? Okay, they literally work for a living. And yet, you know, they play more than we do, even though we have an entire civilization of people working to make things efficient. I just don't buy it. You know, how come anthropologists found, this was a real study, a long-term study, how come anthropologists found that life was dramatically simpler when we hunted our own food? Like, we've totally missed the point with technology, obviously. So, but this is the beautiful thing, okay? It's not even that hard, concretely, for us in the game industry to make this shift. It's already present in some places, okay? Do not despise these small beginnings, okay? This can affect society's very understanding of play, seriously. Play can affect society's understanding of community, which is sorely needed these days, as I'm sure you can see. It can affect people on an individual level, okay? But play, for the sake of play, comes from that thing I mentioned before that we don't talk much about in this field, okay? It's that unconditionality, right? For something to be unconditional means it has no conditions for being true, okay? We deal with conditionals constantly. I mean, the medium basically doesn't exist without it. If-then statements and code, switch statements. You have when conditions, obviously, etc. I mean, when something's unconditional, it doesn't matter the circumstances, though. Okay. For example, if you unconditionally respect your players, you love them as human beings, okay, and don't prioritize them under your deadlines and your monetization, then that particular gap can be bridged. You'll be making the game for the sake of their play, okay? When I got literal death threats and internet trolls following me around the internet after I released my first game, Colby in Search of Floyd, that's a little kid's game, like, people are crazy. I forgave them, unconditionally. They probably still don't like me, but whatever, you know? If you don't think you can make a game, like, if you don't think you can make a game in that type of mindset, then you don't have to make that game. You can make a different game. It's okay. You don't jump after the trends, especially if people are hate mining. So it would be devaluing your time in exchange for devaluing their time. Okay. too many games took so much time from the developers just to take more time from the players. I mean, I think we've created our own time inflation, you know, instead of just our currency inflation. That's its own talk. So, I mean, we can't even be thinking of our games as requiring hours and hours for the player to get even the smallest thing out of it, okay? We just can't be thinking like that. I mean, how many people, let's say 30s, 40s, 50s, even 60s, used to play games, but they're like, I just don't have the time to play video games anymore. Like, this is sad. Another thing I think is the fault of the industry, okay? The quote-unquote big games that get talked about are often, not all the time, but often so ridiculously inflated. I mean, in terms of the player time requirement, okay? I agree with those people. I don't want to waste my time on those games. I don't care how good people tell me the game is. If it requires 100 hours from me just to get something out of it, I can guarantee you I don't play that game. Like, just straight up. And that's the thing. I've spent many hundreds of hours in, like, in Quake 3 Arena. Okay, dude, who knows? But it didn't say that up front. I was just intrigued by the game. I loved it the first time I played it, okay? It didn't say I had to play 100 hours. I ended up playing, who knows, probably 3,000, 4,000 hours in that game. I got to play the game just for the sake of playing it. That time thing. If you can sit down and play when it works for your life, that's part of unconditionally respecting the player's time when you're designing a game, okay? Respect what the players have within them to express, okay? They're not just usernames on the screen with bank accounts attached, okay? These are human beings, okay? So human beings like us, with lives they're living. They have stories too. I mean, think of the user-generated content, okay? Some people do some kind of beautiful and profound things, and it's just like a mod in Doom. Really amazing stuff, but that's the kind of stuff we can prioritize, okay? It's a little bit different shift, okay? And I mean, so like the kind of emergent player-appreciated expression in gameplay has sometimes been a sort of beautiful accident. Bob Ross. Like, think of the movement options in Super Smash Bros. Melee. Like, come on. Wave dashing, wave landing, all the animation canceling that you can do, like auto cancels, L cancels. It's just amazing. I mean, and it's really become a highlight in life for many people and, like, ingrained in that community. They're literally expressing themselves, and this is what they say. They're literally expressing themselves through the movement of their character while they play. It's like dancing, and it's often really amazing. They're like musicians, no exaggeration. So, Quake 3 is another game with totally broken movement physics, but it resulted in a beautiful and unique flow of gameplay. There are even mods for Quake 3, such as Defrag, where you don't even fight anybody else. You just race, and you make demos to upload, like, how fast and creatively you can move through the map. And they put some really awesome music, and it's a good time. So, and sometimes, friends just want to express love in a community. A local community, in person, in the same room. I mean, as much as I've played online, because that was Quake 3, I didn't really have anybody, I played on Virginia servers all the time. I would play in servers in Poland just because somehow they had a good ping, you know. But if I play in person, that's a whole different experience, okay? Multiplayerlocal.com. So, as a game developer, I've included my own expression through mechanics as well. So, Golby in Search of Floyd, there is no floor through the core levels, even though it's a platformer, okay? So, everything is just objects flying by that you can jump on. So this was a way to express living day-to-day at that time in my life with this assurance of things hoped for, a conviction of things not seen, okay? In Signal and Noise, the music-driven rail shooter, driven by live music, I added a mode called Creative Mode for when someone doesn't like how the game is automatically generating gameplay from the music. So that way they can orchestrate the game themselves to the live music using their controls while someone else is playing the game they're orchestrating. People had a blast to play through last month with that mode, by the way. So some people try to like demolish the person next to them that's playing, you know, all in good fun. But like, sometimes it'd be the opposite. Like, oh, he's having a hard time, I'm gonna give him more health, you know. And then other people, you know, sometimes those same people they were trying to interpret the music creatively, almost like they were accompanying the music, not even just dancing. It was really, really, they were doing some things I hadn't thought of. It's just, it's really, really cool. That's just pure expression. It's pure play for the sake of play. They're not trying to get a high score. It's just cool. And I'm a serious high score chaser. Donkey Kong. Yeah, so the carrot we've been chasing of this emergent gameplay honestly might just come down to letting the players do what we don't expect. But without requiring a ton of time to get started. And I'm gonna be transparent. Even Breath of the Wild was too slow for me. I know it's a masterpiece, but too much time. So we need to respect each other as developers too. Okay? It bothers me very deeply when there's a lack of forgiveness. Okay? Yeah, people do dumb things. Of course, I'm definitely not gonna downplay that, but people do some downright awful things that ruin lives, okay? But that's unconditional forgiveness, okay? My mentor, I mentioned about the March 21st, 2019 at GDC. I forgave my mentor. I forgave him, okay? We need to stop separating each other and ostracizing people in our field. It's already hard enough to make games. It's already hard enough. If we work together better than the other media industries, dude, we've got it. We've got it, okay? We've got it made at that point, right? It's terrible competition if you're ostracizing people. It's anti-competition, honestly. Okay? And that makes for worse markets for our games. And obviously that makes for worse products. The irony is, you know, when people orchestrating the ostracizing end up ostracized. It's really just sad. It's very destructive. That's a whole separate conversation, but forgiveness works wonders, okay? Hate is just setting things on fire. So unconditional respect, unconditional forgiveness, unconditional play, that unconditional expression in that play, okay? That's like a master musician playing from the heart, okay? Crying, drawing tears from the surrounding people, or the opposite, laughing and making people dance. That's what we need to strive for in games, okay? It's not out of our reach. It's already done. Even accidentally, it's being done, okay? We don't need to be prioritizing our fake Game of the Year awards and money, because it gets more and more worthless by the month anyway. But I want you to try to remember in the past when you've experienced something from a game. Close your eyes if you need to. Remember it in the past when you've experienced something from a game and it was so awesome that you put down the controller or you took your hands off the mouse and keyboard and just existed, amazed. Like not needing to play anymore at the moment, but you realize you're living life more fully. Like it's a real thing, okay? It might have been an escape at first, maybe, but it didn't just pull you in to keep you there, okay? It changed you, and it sent you out into the world. And that type of experience isn't just limited to within games either, okay? Sometimes it's meta-narratives from the game itself. Like when I had severe self-confidence issues, like severe, pushing myself in games like Mario Kart DS and Quake 3 helped pull me from that. I met incredible people through competitive gaming and I learned a lot about myself. When my life was falling apart, after I lost my brother, and I later than I wanted to quit the game industry, after years of just, you know, using willpower, you know, to act positive, to support my teammates, that's what brought me to Jesus. And to say my life was transformed by that would be an understatement. But anyway, last year, to honor the memory of my brother, I got the world record speedrun for Earthworm Jim Special Edition. 25 years after that first day, we played that game together. My life has happened as a metagame to these games, okay? And that's just something I'm compelled to express at this point, and to express it playfully. So it's in these ideas, in these stories, including the stories in your hearts of how you got here today, that's where the beginning of our way towards games as expression, that's where that exists. Okay. This is a deep problem in our culture that we're fortunate enough to be in a position to shift, but only together. Okay. I don't want to see the future of games continuing exactly the way it is right now. And I don't think any of you do either. That's why you're here in this room, okay? All that that starts with each of us trying to live unconditionally so that we can play unconditionally, okay? We need to rethink what's really important in the long term, right? We need to rethink the influence of people with adverse priorities, okay? We need to cooperate on experiments larger than single companies, okay? We need to talk vulnerably, we need to love unconditionally, and that, again, play for the sake of play, even ourselves. Even if we're not professional gamers, that's part of you as a person, that's part of you in your life. Play these games, okay? Doing that, we will grow as people as we play games of expression together. So, one last thing. So, if you go to salamis.com and you sign up for the email newsletter, I'll soon be giving some games as gifts to our current subscribers. So, like, at that point, whoever subscribed will get those games for free. Feel free to email me if you want. You know, you'll rarely ever see me on social media anymore, so I didn't even put that on there. But anyway, thank you guys. Now time for Q&A.
Such a disconnect now, especially with AAA games, is because they're focusing less on the creative aspect of it and more on we need to get this out as soon as possible, and there's just because of that a lack of disconnect and a lack of creativity being involved with it these days, or?
Yes, I think attached to that, so the question I'm going to try to reiterate is the camera all right, so I'll try. You're asking if with the AAA games, all that disconnect I was talking about with them,
we all know about it anyway,
the disconnect where the player's field is completely like in a whole other universe from the company making the game, you know, maybe there's a community manager or whatever, is that because of the deadline, like that kind of deadline culture, just pushing it out the door, whatever, if it doesn't match up with expectations, is that right? Okay. I think it's several parts, and I think if we're just honest with ourselves, it's just apparent, even in smaller companies, not even just AAA necessarily, that culture of like, even in the 80s this was already the case, well, 70s actually, late 70s for Atari this was a thing, because this culture pushed towards that horribly rushed ET release in 82. So trying to meet the holiday season, okay, that's not going to make your game better. But that's what we're doing. It's like, that's the common wisdom. It's like, oh, you want to get it out, put your deadline out, we'll get the game out, and if it fails, whatever. We can't be thinking if it fails, whatever. We got expectations. We're already losing our reputation as a whole. Like, don't think, oh, well, there's always going to be a company who's messing with it. No, we need to take responsibility. We need to take responsibility. It's hard. I screwed it up really hardcore, too, okay? It felt horrible, but we need to do something about that, you know. I think it's the rushing out the door, but I also think there's kind of a corporate separation as well, where you have community managers that are separate from the marketing team, and both of those are separate from the development team, and all three of those are separate from the people making the high-level decisions. Especially, that's a huge thing for AAA. You have the publisher making choices on those things, and they barely even get to talk with each other. I think that's a big thing.
Hypothetical. Let's say we have a unique situation where we can contact it, reach out to it, the main primary developer of XYZ game. And we know of this developer's history, maybe jaded or not, positive or negative. What would you suggest in making that initial contact to make the rest of the communication process easy? So, for example, a player with lots of experience and general knowledge of their game that they work hard on. What would they do so they could provide insightful feedback that would benefit maybe like esports communities?
Yeah, well, you said esports, yeah. So so the question, I'm trying to reword it for it, just tell me if I miss it. So the question was about if you have a circumstance or special circumstances to contact the core developer of a game so you can talk directly with them, you know, initiate that, that conversation so that it actually has a positive effect on the game, correct?
Yeah.
So I've got a few examples of that, but I think just to answer the question directly, I think the best way is start by explaining why you think the game is valuable, even if it's flawed, why you think it is valuable. Not, this could be good, but it's not. Like, that's, it's kind of rude, like, maybe it's true, but you know, you want to try to initiate appropriately. As y'all know, development's stressful, okay? You don't want somebody emailing you with that. It's not great. Thanks, you know. Cool, I knew that, it's an alpha, you know, something like that. But if you can keep the conversation extended, like, sometimes companies, they kind of drop the ball. They start really well with feedback from the community or even individuals, and then it kind of just kind of drops off. I don't want to use examples or anything, but I've experienced that with games that report to me, and they just drop off the face of the earth. I mean, it's frustrating for me. I'm sure it's frustrating for the developers, though. So, honestly, it's just start with, this is why I care about this game. There you go. There's framing. That answer?
Thank you.
Yeah.
Would you say that games like Minecraft and Roblox, like those kind of sandbox games, are more valuable with a lot of people to express themselves to one another, or do they really isolate people from one another more? Or which kinds of games would you say would help bring out people's expressions, like instead of isolating them in like their own world?
Such a cool question. I like that. So he's asking. Tell me if I've got it wrong, okay? He's asking for games like Minecraft or Roblox. There's so much user-generated content focus, you know, it's pretty much the whole core of the game, making things that other people can play and use. Is that kind of isolating? And like, how does that fit in with the game's expression, you know, instead of just escaping? Is that right? Okay. So, Minecraft, I think, is been done brilliantly in terms of like building community, because very early on with the game, they already had Minecon. They already had people like in-person communities playing this game. LAN's not the biggest thing, but you know, it's something. And I don't consider Minecraft all that isolating. Roblox, it has a slightly different purpose. It's still that user-generated content thing, you know, but Roblox is very much more in the kind of metaverse direction, kind of. The metaverse direction. It's certainly a very much a front runner. I mean, stock exchange, whoa, you know, bigger than Nintendo, what? You know, but I think that has its own share of problems. I don't think it's necessarily the isolation thing. You know, that company is dealing with a lot of the, there's a lot of controversy with almost the exploitation of developers, and, you know, some of the monetization things they're doing are just blatant. Not great things for children, you know, but I wouldn't say that's necessarily in the sense of that isolation thing, okay? It definitely has a lot of expression potential, but we can learn a lot from games like that, you know, it's perfect learning tool. Okay. Does that answer the question?
Yeah.
Expression or so much user-generated content, that's a real way to like live in the real world, even though it's like it might be separate in some sense. That's where that expression of yourself, like what you experience in the game, it's not necessarily real in the game world, but it is real in real life. Yeah, exactly. That's a good point. Yeah. Any other questions? Yeah.
So it's in a lot of games it's easier to do this in a game like for Quake 3, a game is designed. Or, you know, here's a match, go play it, the match is over.
Sure.
You don't have to keep playing after that point.
Yeah.
Easy. In games where their goal is something like a complex narrative where it's really difficult to compress it into a short period of time,
sure.
How does a developer
So let me reiterate that question. So for some games, think Quake 3, for example, great example, brilliant game. You can do user-generated content. You make a map, for example. Go on the map, have your little insta-jib, whatever, and then you finish the game, somebody wins, somebody loses, and then you leave. But there are other games where there's this longer narrative sequence, and it can take a long time to say something meaningful. Like, how do we approach that as developers? Is that what you're saying? Okay. So to approach the longer form games like that, but have it be expressive, I know I'm saying not so great about Breath of the Wild. I know it's a masterpiece, but I didn't like the game. And I'm a huge Zelda fan. Okay, huge. I didn't like Breath of the Wild. What's wrong with me? You know? And once you get further in the game, it's cool. I'm like, okay, that's great. I'm glad all this is here. But I was burnt out by that point. I'm like, this is too tedious. There are like very fundamental things that I think could be modded in Breath of the Wild, and I would really like the game. But I'm not going to download any mods for the game because I don't care enough. You know, I think that kind of systemic game, so systemic I mean like where you have emergent gameplay from like the elements in the world. And literally in Breath of the Wild, it's literally elements. Like fire will burn a tree down, like, you know, things like that. You can knock over a tree and push it over and use that as a bridge over a gap. And things like that. That's really cool. You don't need 100 hours to do that, and it's like, whoa, that's really awesome, you know. But the longer form stories, I think one of the things that is negative for many reasons in our industry is we're still looking at interactive storytelling. I think we're looking at it from the wrong side. So storytelling is where you have someone telling a story, then you have someone hearing the story or reading a story or whatever, you know. But interactive storytelling, we've made it the same thing, where it's somebody telling a story and then you have someone playing the story. I think that's not interactive storytelling. If you want to have interactive storytelling, you have real characters, not just the cardboard box with the face on it, you know, that says, you know, you make a choice and they're your enemy or you make a choice and they're your friend. You can't just do that. It's too surface level. You don't need something huge. You don't need Mass Effect, okay, to have a compelling story. Play some of those Flash games. And not even the short ones. There are long Flash games that you can play them for a couple minutes, and it's already hooks you meaningfully. You have to have a hook very early on, like minutes in. I'm not saying 5 hours in Elden Ring. I'm saying immediately, very beginning of the game. I am playing Elden Ring, though. I know it's like a 200-hour thing, whatever. It's cool. So you need the hook, and you need to have that kind of systemic approach, where they're literally telling their story in the game with your systems, okay? That's really interactive storytelling. And it's not so tedious to develop. You don't have to take 6 years with 1,000 people to tell a story that they can just tell themselves. Yeah?
So in regards to shifting back to a state of play for the sake of play, do you think it would be beneficial if there was a shift from treating video games as monetary products to treating video games as artistic pieces?
Yeah, definitely. That's such a good question. Okay. That means a lot that you said that. So the question was, tell me if I'm wrong. The question was, with the issue of games being this kind of money product, like this is how you can make revenue for your company, you know, are some of these issues just arising from that instead of it being art, a work of art, you know, your game? And I say, well, definitely, totally. But there are art games. Okay, so honestly, I would consider some of Chris Crawford's early games kind of art games, honestly. Jason Rohrer, in some ways, he's a little controversial guy, whatever. But he makes beautiful games. I mean, he makes beautiful games, and they're super tiny. That's not a huge experience or anything. Maybe 1 hour, one life is a little bit bigger, but that's still a short an hour, you know. But Jason Rohrer, it's Rohrer. Takes some of the stuff with a grain of salt, but he makes beautiful games regardless. And he releases them for free, except for the past, I think, two games he was charging for. Those are very different games from what he's done before. He releases the games for free and just takes donations. Like, the guy, he practices simple living, so he, like, his whole family of, like, five lives on, like, $10,000 a year or something. Like, it's amazing. Because he was like, none of these games are worth my time. Like, I used to like games, I'm a programmer, but I don't want to play these games. I want to make a game that takes like 3 minutes to play. And he was making this beautiful game. Passage is probably my favorite one. I used to have the song as a ringtone, so. But there were still art games. There's not all this, there's hobbyists too that make more commercial seeming products, like this Locomolito in Spain. Wow. One of the best game developers in the world, in my opinion. And he does it for free. He just wants to do it because that's how he expresses himself. And he plays for the sake of play. He still goes to arcade conventions, and he doesn't even bring his own games. He's just there to play the games. I mean, we need more Locomolitos in the industry, and we'll be good. But yeah, so I think we're running out of time. I need to go back to my booth, though. If you guys come, I'll answer whatever, and we can hang out and talk about Donkey Kong. But yeah, thank you for being here.